Morning. Good morning to all of you.
Today we have the pleasure of a very distinguished mathematician
who is going to talk about the ranking concepts and in general how to increase perhaps the ranking of different institutes. Professor Rangarajan is a professor in the Department of Mathematics, IIT Bangalore. He did his integrative MSc from British Columbia in 1985 and a PhD in University of Maryland in 1990. And subsequently, of course, he has been very illustrious in his academic career. He is a fellow of many academies. But currently, he is a chairman of Division of Interdisciplinary Research, IIT Bangalore, and the director of Indo-French Center for Applied Mathematics, convener in IIT Mathematics Initiatives, and a coordinator of DST Center for Mathematical Biology. Okay, so with that, I request him to come and provide this particular lecture. May I also request all of you to switch off or keep your mobile on silent mode. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. So I'll be talking on, talking about comparative analysis of university rankings. Of course, the first thing to worry about or wonder is whether, you should be interested in rankings, So this is, of course, a debatable point. But I think whether you hate it or like it, it's probably not possible to ignore it these days. Because MHRD uses the rankings, in MOUs with various institutions, it puts rankings as one of the parameters, it will look at when it's evaluating progress. Of course, whenever rankings come out, it's these days front page news in the newspapers, which university came first, which came second, and why are we so behind, and all these things. So, being public institutions, I assume all are from public institutions?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, being public institutions, of course, we are answerable to the public, we are using public money. So, therefore, when it becomes public news, then again, it's something which that we have to take note of, these rankings, what, how we do. But I would say, other than all that, maybe, one can use rankings as a tool. One should not get obsessed with them, but one can use them as a tool to see how we are doing. Benchmark ourselves against the best see how we can improve ourselves. So I think that is the spirit in which we should look at the rankings. So let me give you a sort of introduction, because before, I don't know the background, because I'm starting from the basics, looking at various metrics which go into rankings, looking at the pitfalls of these metrics, and then we'll look at the different rankings which are available. So I'll start with something which has been around the longest, which is the impact factor. So this, Eugene Garfield, his picture is there, he introduced the citation index and the impact factor. And this was way back in the 60s. And basically, this launched the practice of evaluating researchers quantitatively, even though it was not meant to, as we'll see. So it was actually meant for librarians to evaluate journals and see which journals to subscribe to and which journals not to subscribe to. But it has become a practice, this thing. So on this, of course, there's been a lot of criticism of the impact factor. For example, David Colquhoun says that this invention of Eugene Garfield, a man who has done enormous harm to true science. So, how do you calculate the impact factor? So, you look at the number of articles, article citations. So, suppose you are interested in calculating the impact factor of a journal in 2014. You look at the number of article citations in 2014 to articles published in 2012 and 2013. So if you're looking at a current year, you look at the papers published in the previous 2 years and see how many citations to these papers have happened in the current year. Okay. So, and then you divide by the number of articles published in 2012 and 2013. That gives you the impact factor of 2000 for that. For example, if The journal has received 1,500 citations in 2014, 350 articles published in 2012, and 400 articles published in 2013. Then you have your impact factor. The bottom is 750, E50 plus 400. So you have an impact factor of 2, okay, for 2014. So this is how you calculate the impact factor. This also, you know, people felt sometimes that impact factor is too, you know, narrow in the sense that it only looks at citations after 2 years or even, you know, either 1 or 2 years depending on when it was published. So there is something called a 5-year impact factor, where if you want to look at, say, citations in 1992, then you look at articles published in 1987 to 91, a 5-year period. And so that becomes the numerator, citations, and B is articles published in 1987 to 91, and A over B gives you the 5-year impact factor. Okay, so you have therefore a regular impact factor, which is, you can think of it as a 2-year impact factor, and then you have a 5-year impact factor, which probably looks at, you know, considers articles which may get slow in taking off, but then after a few years they become more cited. Of course, there are also what are called sleeping beauties. You know, some articles which have not been cited for 10, 15 years, and suddenly the field takes off, and then, you know, they get started citing. So none of these factors account for such papers, but those are quite rare. You know, those sort of papers. Okay, so for example, if you look at example, Nature's impact factor in 2017 is 42. That means, on the average, papers published in Nature in 2015 and 2016 have an average citation of 42 each in 2017. And 5-year impact factor is 45. Okay, so in the 5-year period preceding 2017, each paper on the average received 45 citations. So this is how you calculate, you know, the impact factor. Look at it. This tells you the difference. This tells you the difference between the 5-year and the 2-year impact factors. So you see that some journals, the 5-year impact factor is substantially more, and so on. So these are various journals, just to illustrate that there can be differences in the 2-year and the 5-year impact factor. So basically that's how it was defined, and as I said, it was originally designed to evaluate journals for library purposes, and it was also designed to compare journals within particular fields. Okay, so that was the original aim, but now higher impact factor has become synonymous with greater impact and quality, and so therefore journals having great higher impact factor have become more prestigious, like Nature or Science and so on. So therefore, publishing in a high impact factor has also become prestigious because of this. And this is where the unfortunate thing happened, that publishing in a high quality, high impact factor journal became a measure, a surrogate measure of the quality of the researcher. Okay. So it's not just promotions, etc. In China, if you see in 2016, the average reward of a publication for a single paper in Nature and Science was $44,000, and the highest payment was $165,000, which is much higher than the annual salary of the Chinese professors. So China has gone the way of just rewarding its researchers for publishing in high impact journals, and that of course has led to a lot of problems, claims of forgery and things like that, because once and then ghostwriting, because you want to get into high impact journals, so you start sharing the rewards and so on. So a lot of unsavory practices also have come up because of this. But there are many pitfalls. For example, if you look at the subject wise variation in impact factor, you see that there's a huge variation across subjects. If you look at the mean impact factor of journals in life sciences, it's very high. But if you look at, say, social sciences, it's very low, and so on. Math and computer science is even lower, and things. So you have a wide variation. If you just use impact factor without qualifying it in any way, then, because, for example, you often see some order from the government or something saying that we'll only count papers published in journals with impact factor greater than one, say. Okay. But that does disservice to areas where the impact factor is very low, you know, like mathematics and so on. So where, you know, there may be hardly two or three journals with impact factor very high. You know, most of the journals have very low impact factor. So in so therefore, one has to be careful in looking at, comparing across subjects using the impact factor. And also, you see that as the mean number of authors per paper increases, the impact factor of, also increases. In subject area. So therefore, again, you see that as you have more collaborators, the impact factor tends to increase because obviously, I mean, you have more collaborators, they also tend to cite the papers and things like that, and so it the impact factor increases. And even, you forget about cross fields, even within fields, there are variations in impact factor. For example, if you look at physics, astronomy and astrophysics has a very, within that category, has a high impact factor, and mathematical physics, you know, usually mathematics, wherever mathematics appears, it's the villain of the piece. So mathematics then is very low. Okay, so you have therefore within the subject variations. This is in science, in engineering again. If you see material science, again there is a huge difference between impact factors of different sub-areas in material science. So therefore, it's very difficult, it is, as you can imagine, it's very wrong to use impact factor to compare researchers. Okay, saying that if a researcher has published in a high impact factor journal, then this person should be rewarded, because a person working in, say, textiles, the impact factor is going to be low. You know, whatever the, he may be publishing the best paper in the world, but the impact factor is going to be very low on the average. And also, of course, the impact factor changes over time. I mean, the year you publish a paper in the journal, the impact factor may be a certain value. And if you are being evaluated, say, 4 or 5 years hence, then at that time, the impact factor may be different. And often, administrators will only look at the current impact factor. They will not look at the impact factor when you publish the paper. Okay. So if you're fortunate, the impact factor has gone up. But if you're unfortunate, the impact factor may have gone down since you published. So then, you will have a problem in using this. So, of course, this is sort of on a lighter side. So this is yet another way of measuring impact. You take the, this person is comparing science and JBC, Journal of Biological Chemistry. So as you know, science comes in a very thin volume. JBC comes in a very thick volume. So the person just hits this other person with the two volumes and says JBC has a higher impact compared to. So, just tells you in some sense how sort of silly it is to compare. But these, more than this, probably this slide captures what is even more worrisome about the impact factor. In fact, Philip Campbell was then the editor-in-chief of Nature. He stepped down this year. He did an analysis, and 89% of our impact factor in 2004 was generated by just 25% of our papers. It's the usual Pareto rule, 80% contributes. 20% contributes 80%, so on. So, basically, just because you have a publication in a high-impact journal doesn't mean that your paper is good. Okay. So, it is just that it happened to clear the benchmark. Various reasons. It could be the referees happened to like your paper, it was in a very fashionable field, and so on. So, it may have just gotten through into a paper, but it doesn't, if it did not have the basic fundamental insight which supposedly a paper in Nature is supposed to have, it may not get cited at all. So as you can see, 75% of the papers done in Nature not get cited much at all. So just because you have a paper in Nature doesn't mean anything. So that is the other problem. So it is better to look at citations to individual papers. If you want to quantify things, it's at least look at citations to individual papers. Don't look at the journals in which they are published. Okay. And also typically, you know, society journals do not have very high impact factors, but they tend to be very reputed in that field. So again, going by the impact factor would do us a disservice to these sort of society journal. So in fact, Garfield himself recognized it. He said that the use of journal impacts in evaluating individuals has its inherent dangers. In an ideal world, evaluators would read each article and make personal judgments. So this is a recurring theme. You'll see that several people have come out with the statement that when you are evaluating people for promotions or hirings, ultimately the only thing which you can do, which is the best, is to actually read the papers. Experts should read the papers and come to a subjective decision. That is where, of course, the balance is a problem. Because once it is subjective, then you read about RTI or you read about lawsuits and so on. So the citation index or impact factor gives you an easy way out. You just say, okay, I looked at all these impact factors. This person is higher, so I am selecting this person. Whereas ultimately what works is you read the papers and then see whether it has made a significant contribution to the area, and if it has, irrespective of where it is published, then you should give weightage to that. So this is what the three academies here had put up. So evaluation requires peer review by acknowledged experts working to the highest ethical standards and focusing on intellectual merits and scientific achievements. Bibliometric data cannot be used as a proxy for expert assessment. Well-founded judgment is essential. Overemphasis on such metrics may seriously damage scientific creativity and originality. Expert peer review should be treated as a valuable resource. So ultimately, this is what helps, and this is what we should all go to. But as I said, from an administration viewpoint, there are also all these problems when you have these subjective judgments. In fact, San Francisco Declaration of Research Assessment, called DORA, that made a general recommendation that do not use journal-based metrics such as journal impact factor as a surrogate measure of the quality of individual research articles to assess individual scientists. So contributions, whether you are using it for hiring, promotion, or funding decisions. So basically, you should not use the journal impact factor as to judge individual researchers. And DORA also had this recommendation for institutions and funding agencies: be explicit about the criteria used to reach hiring, tenure, and promotion decisions, clearly highlighting, especially for early stage investigators, this is very important, especially assistant professors are very anxious about the process and how they'll get evaluated. So basically, you should say the scientific content of paper is much more important than the publication merits, metrics, or the identity of the journal in which it's published. So basically, again, all these statements tell you that unfortunately, whether we like it or not, finding whether a person is good or not is finally a subjective judgment of experts, and it's very difficult to get around that. Again, another recommendation by DORA for institutions and funding agencies. So it says, for the purpose of research assessment, consider the value and impact of all research outputs, including data sets and software. This is something which we often ignore in academic institutions. We tend to sort of play down contributions to software, data sets, or building and equipment and things like that. So we always focus on rewarding people with high impact papers. So in addition to, so you have to look at all research outputs in addition to research publications, and you have to look at a broad range of impact measures, including qualitative indicators of research impact, such as influence on policy and practice. This is again something which we never look at. That is how the paper is influencing future policy in that area, how it's influencing national government policy. So these are things which we normally don't care about when evaluating publications. So these also should be looked at. So on the whole, it should be a holistic evaluation of that individual's contribution. So not just in terms of publications, but even if you only take publications as a metric for evaluation, for promotion and hiring, even then it should be a subjective evaluation based on peer review and not on counting these metrics, especially not the impact factor. And for researchers, for all of us who are involved in various committees and so on, when involved in committees, so make assessments based on scientific content rather than publication metrics. And also when you are writing papers, basically cite the primary literature in which the observations are first reported and not the review article. Because all of us tend to be lazy and just cite the review article which summarizes all the findings in that area. But then that gives more and more importance to the review article, and the primary article in which that actually happened gets lost along the way. So therefore, you are again, you know, not being fair to the original contributor of that idea. So it's the review or the article which gets all the credit in some sense. And then there are, even when putting your same work report for promotion and all that, so it says use a range of article metrics and so on. And also, if you see such practices, it asks researchers to challenge such practices of using general impact factors for evaluating researchers. But then what is the reality? We may say all this, but what actually happens on the field? Okay, so this is a survey done by Nature. And what they found was that almost 80% of the institutions and departments get influenced by these metrics in hiring decisions, in tenure decisions, in promotion decisions. And of course, this is not applicable in India, but they are in salary decisions and performance reviews and allocations of resources, maybe less. But you see that things which are faculty are most worried about hiring and promotion and tenure, there the reality is that these factors do play an important role. So it is just not possible to ignore these factors, how much ever we may want to. That seems to be the reality. And again, these metrics are so seductive because they just give you a number by which you can compare different researchers. The job of the administrator becomes very easy compared to looking at the papers, reading the papers, and making judgments based on those. Okay. So a better metric rather than a general impact factor is what is called the source normalized impact per paper. So this corrects for differences in citation practices among different areas. So this allows for a more accurate between field comparisons of citation impact. For example, if I look at SNP for 2015 journals, Nature has a SNP of 8.1 and Annals of Mathematics has a SNP of 5.4. Okay, so now you see that they are comparable in terms of SNP. Whereas if you look at in terms of impact factor, Nature is 42 and Annals of Mathematics is only 3. Okay, so therefore this sort of normalizes across fields in some way, so that you are better able to compare articles published in different journals. So if at all you want to use metrics for journals, then it's better to use such a metric rather than the general impact factor. But probably the metric which now many people have started using is the citation per paper. So you basically divide the number of citations of a person or an institution or whatever you are considering, or a school or whatever department. You divide the number of citations by the number of papers, and you fix the periods appropriately. Typically, a 5-year period is considered for publications, and a 6-year period, which has one extra year to allow for citations in that year, for the citation. So that is how it is done. So as I said, it can be computed for researchers, departments, institutions, whatever you want. But even here, you should be again careful that you compute it for each subject area separately, or you normalize it appropriately. For example, again, you see that citations per paper is very different across fields. So you should not be comparing across fields using citation per paper. Even though on the whole, citation per paper is a better measure. Again, the ideal thing would still be to read the papers, but if you want to have objective measures, it's because we have to face the reality that is, you know, people want to use such objective measures, then at least use citations per paper, which is at least measures the impact. It doesn't look at the source at all. It doesn't care whether you published in Timbuktu Journal or Nature. As long as you have citations for that paper, then it gives you credit for that. Other to compare across field is what is called the field weighted citation impact. So you have indicates, how the number of citations received by an institution's publications compares with the average number of citations received by all other similar publications. Okay, so you see how basically this compares how you are doing. It can be done at an individual level also. You are it tells you how you are doing compared to the world average. Okay, so you look at similar publications across, published all over the world, see how many citations they get, and then you compare it with the publications that you have in that same area and see how many citations you get and see whether you are above or below the world average. So essentially that's how it does. So similar publications are those publications that are the same year, publication type and discipline. It uses citations received in the year of publications plus the following 3 years. So citation impact equal to 1 means you are equal impact to the world average. Citation impact equal to 0.8 means you are 20% less than the world average, and 1.2 would mean you are 20% more than the world average. So it is useful to benchmark different areas regardless of differences in size, disciplinary profile, age and publication type composition. So in a way, this again normalizes between different fields. The only thing is it now compares you across the against the world average for that area. Then the other popular metric is the H index. So basically here you look at all the papers published by a person or by institution or a group, it doesn't matter what entity you are considering, then order them in a descending order based on the number of citations that the paper has received. So you have this paper has received a lot of citations, keeps dropping. Now you draw a square of size H and keep on increasing the size of the square until it intersects with this curve. Okay. So basically then where it intersects the curve, this tells you that H, what does it tell you? When it intersects the curve, it tells you that this person or institution has H papers each which have been cited at least H times. Okay. So that becomes the H index. So this is how you determine the H index. And this is again a very popular measure of the impact of a person or an individual.
What is E square?
Oh, that tells you about, you see the same paper, these papers have received much higher citations. This also counts the other citations, but that's not used in the calculation. It's just to illustrate that there could be other citations. So for example, if you have very few highly cited papers, then the curve would look like this and your H would be small. And if you have large number of highly cited papers, your curve would have a broader area here and your H index would be higher. So this another popular measure. But again, it does not distinguish between different types of researchers. For example, both these researchers have the same H index, but this is a selective researcher who publishes only a few papers, and the papers this person publishes are very highly cited. Okay, but he publishes does not publish many, he or she. Whereas this large producer researcher publishes many papers and then still has the same H index. So those papers all are just above this value H, none of it really stands out. They're all sort of reasonably good, but nothing great, you know. Whereas this person, the selective researchers, you know, probably is publishing really great papers, you know. But then both have the same H index. So again, you have this issue of comparing different types of researchers using the H index. And it does not also tell you the H index, the stage of your career. For example, if you are an early career, an assistant professor just coming in, you may have a few, you know, papers which are very highly cited, but you have not produced that much because you are very early in your career. So your H index is 4. On the other hand, a mid-career associate professor may have 12 papers, but not too many citations. Again, the person's index is 4. So it really does not tell you, whereas you would like to think that researcher A is doing better than researcher B. Okay, but again, the H index does not distinguish between these two. Also, it does not tell you whether you are the first author or the 14th author on the groundbreaking paper, because it is not count the author order. It does not take into account author order. It matters in some areas like biology. Biology, you know, either the only two things which count from what I gather is you are either the first author or the corresponding author. Nothing else matters. And of course, now to beat the system, you'll have biology papers with 3-4 first authors, 2-3 corresponding authors, because you know it's becoming very difficult to give credit. So, on the other hand, in mathematics, it's often that you publish in alphabetical order. So, the authors are listed in alphabetical order. Then, you know, if you use this, you know, if you want distinguish between first and last author, it becomes a problem. Also, it does not tell you whether the citations are due to positive or negative references. If you have written a bad paper, you know, people for some time maybe citing that to tell you how bad the paper is, how wrong the results are. But even that gets cited, you know, that is also a citation. It does not count, you know, whether it is due to positive or negative references. And of course, the good thing about impact factor is it doesn't care about the journals you have published in, you know. So it takes care of that problem with the impact factor. It is only concerned with the number of citations to your paper. So now I've told you about different metrics which go into all these things. Now let's get into, you know, the rankings themselves. What sort of, you know, different type of rankings there are, you know. So there are many rankings, you know, probably the right now the most popular are the Times Higher Education rankings and the QS World rankings. ARWU, the Academic Ranking of World Universities, among the world rankings was the oldest. But the really oldest is, of course, the US News and World Report rankings for the US universities. So that started in the early 1980s. So it has been ranking, and that is sort of considered the gold standard for US universities. They don't care, as usual, the US doesn't care about the world. So the only thing it cares about is the rankings locally. So all US institutions don't worry about the world rankings at all. They only concentrate on the US News and World Report. So you have therefore you know these different rankings, and of course, as you know, MHRD has started this NARF recently, a few years ago, and many other rankings. So we'll go through some of them, look at you know, look at them in detail, see sort of you know what are the factors that go into these university rankings. So now, if you look at the THE ranking methodology, this sort of summarizes the methodology. So it gives 30% weightage to teaching, 30% to research, 30% to citations, 7.5% to international outlook, and 2.5% to industry income. So here, in case you know that was not very clear, so this summarizes the different contributions of different areas. Now let's go into each one of them. So teaching is 30%. That comprises the following components: reputational survey, that's a huge part of it, 15%, student to staff ratios 4.5%, doctorate to bachelor's ratios 2.25%, number of doctorates awarded per faculty 6%, and institutional income per faculty member is 2.25%. So if you look at the reputational survey, so the, in 2018, yeah.
Student to staff ratio 4.5%. What is the ideal ratio by which they can do maximum?
Oh, okay. Always, all these ranking agencies take the number one university as 100%. Okay, everything else is scaled in that
manner. So the scores that you see in all these rankings are not absolute scores. They are always relative to the number one.
I'll come to that. So basically, the doctorate to bachelor ratio, essentially, you see all these rankings, even though, you know, they pay lip service to teaching and all that, they're all essentially research education based. So the more doctorates you have, the more research that you do. So this, that's what counted that way. But the way it is usually phrased is saying that, you know, you are, have more doctorates, which is also a valid point, that you are training the future academics, you know, and the future research. So therefore, that should count faster.
THE does a reputation survey in 2018, for example, it got 10,000 responses from 138 countries. And they were combined with the results of the 2017 survey, so they got a total of 20,000 responses for these reputation surveys. And it examined the perceived prestige of the institutions in teaching. So each person can name at most 15 universities. Okay. So there's no this thing. You just have to see whatever comes to your mind. As the top universities, you put them in. Okay. You can't rank your own university there. So excluding your own university, you put 15 other universities. As you can imagine, this is very subjective. So
well-established universities like Harvard, Princeton, Stanford, obviously always get very high marks in these sort of surveys.
Sir, who are these respondents?
Oh, they just send it to all, you know, many, many people. So, for example, every year I receive this thing asking me to rank institutions. So, it is just sent to many people, but only about 10,000 or so respond every year. QS is better. They have about 80,000 people in that survey. It is basically voluntary. I mean, they send out to many people So it could be a biased sample and so many things. There are so many issues with the reputation ranking.
Do they equally distribute it amongst countries or?
Yeah, that is the next slide.
So this tells you the geographical distribution of the people. So basically Asia 32%, the North America 22% and so on. So basically they weighted the responses so that it reflects the geographical distribution of the scholars. Based on the event data, they weighted it so that all regions have weight proportional to the number of researchers they have in that area. And subject-wise, this is a subject-wise distribution of the responses. Again, you see that the subjects are not equally represented. Engineering, physical sciences, life sciences, clinical, computer science, they all dominate in as far as the subjects are concerned. There's again another issue. Okay, and then the other is student to staff ratio, 4.5%. I mean, this of course is a proxy in some sense for teaching quality.
So if you have a very high staff to student ratio, that means you are
the class sizes tend to be small, and therefore you are doing better teaching. And then you also have doctorate to bachelor's ratio. So as I mentioned earlier, this tells you how committed an institution is to nurturing the next generation of academics. And the number of doctorates awarded per faculty member, just given 6%. So this tells you, how many people you are training per faculty. And it's also normalized to take into account the university's subject mix, because some areas you produce many more doctorates than in other areas, so it takes care of such differences between subject areas. And the institutional income per faculty member, so this is scaled against the faculty member, so it's normalized with respect to the faculty member. It's also normalized for purchasing power parity.
In case you don't know, purchasing power parity essentially allows you a more realistic comparison of different currencies. For example, you know, when you're comparing dollar against rupee, right now it's about 72 rupees to a dollar. But that is not thought to be the true purchasing power of the rupee. No. So, for example, if you if you get a haircut in India, it may cost you some 100 rupees, whereas the same thing costs you, you know, $20 in New York. So obviously, that doesn't correspond to an exchange rate of 72 rupees to a dollar, and so on. So you can what they do is they compare a basket of commodities, services, etc., and see how they each cost, and then weight it according to that, and then give a purchasing power parity. So that roughly comes to around 18 rupees to a dollar. So that is a PPP. But in IAC, we did we even calculated a PPP more geared towards scientific research, because whenever we talked about PPP here, people would complain, oh no, in science we need to purchase equipment. Equipments are all purchased in dollars, so we cannot use the usual PPP calculations. So we did a more detailed calculations where we took $1 spent on equipment, consumables, AMC, all these to be equal to 73 rupees, because you are paying in dollars there using the nominal exchange rate. And $1 spent on salaries scaled by a factor of 5, on faculty salaries is scaled by a factor of 5, and so on. So, but then if you do all that, again it turns out that the overall PPP comes out to roughly again 18 rupees to a dollar. Because your bulk of your spending is on salaries, of any institution. So therefore, that sort of averages out things, and you still get that. So this institutional income, of course, gives you a sense of what sort of infrastructure and facilities are available to the students and faculty. Then the research is 30%, and here the reputation survey again. 80% research income per faculty member 6, and number of papers published per faculty normalized by area is 6%. So this measures university's reputation for excellence. Again, it's done the same way. The same survey asks for both teaching and research. So you again rank top 15 institutions based on what you feel are the best institutions. And then you have research income per faculty member. This again scaled for faculty members and adjusted for PPP. Of course, this can be influenced by national policy and so on, economic circumstances. Developed countries, the spending will be more. In developing countries, the spending will be less, and so on. So those caveats are definitely there. And again, it's normalized by subjects, since, for example, in science, the research grants tend to be much higher than in social sciences, say. So, number of papers published per faculty normalized for the area. This again is just counts the number, and you are scaled for institutional size and normalized for the subject. Then this is a big, portion of the rankings. Citations normalized for the subject area. So
we consider only Scopus index papers.
Sorry? Yes, these are all, both THE and QS are all based on Scopus. ARWU is based on Web of Science. So, but these two are based on Scopus index. So this has the highest weightage. So this essentially measures the citations per paper published by the university, but it's normalized for the subject area. It's also normalized for the country, so that's supposed to give a benefit to countries like India, because there's another, worry about these citations, that if you are in the West, then your papers, the same paper tends to get cited more, an equal quality paper tends to get cited more in the West as if it were published from a Western university as compared to from an Indian university, because of the networks and so on. So this sort of adjusts for that variations in country wise. And also, of course, you have this issue of papers with more than 1,000 authors, which is very common in higher energy physics, where you conduct large experiments and you have thousands of authors on those. So how do you allocate credit in such cases? Because they are highly cited, because 1,000 authors, and they are usually, they report discovery of new particles and so on. So they get to be cited hugely, So how do you give credit for such things? So initially, they were giving full credit to it. Then they sort of, the pendulum swung the other way. They said no credit to such papers to anybody. But now the thinking is we'll give little bit of credit to the authors of such papers. This is one reason. You may recall, some years ago, if you have seen Punjab University, even now it does well, but Punjab University used to do extremely well in the rankings. It was often number one and so on. That is because they had several high energy, particle physicists, experimental particle physicists, and so there their papers used to generate huge number of citations. Okay, so now just a minimum of 5% is given to each institution, and then there's a proportionately larger contribution. International outlook is given 7.5%, is the ratio of international to domestic students, and ratio of international to domestic staff, each carry 2.5%, and fraction of papers having foreign co-authors. This is 2.5%. So as long as you have one co-author from an outside university or elsewhere, not in your own country, then it's counted, and it's also normalized for subject area. Then you have the industry income, which is again adjusted for PPP and scaled against the number of faculty. Yeah.
This is the, I think, weakest link for Indian industry, right?
You see, I've done many such analysis for IAC and other places. So basically, it's true, but I think people tend to use this as an excuse very often. Even if you exclude this, because it's only 7.5%, So even if you exclude it, I've done the whole analysis excluding all these things, still the picture doesn't change that much, So, people always talk about this, but I think, it is a valid thing. Yeah, it is true that we suffer because of this, but I think it's not. Where it may help is, say, if you are, most Indian universities are in 200 to 300, that sort of range. There probably it still helps, even 1% here and there will pull you up a little bit. But if you want to break, really be, in the top 100, then it really doesn't matter. So, so you can also do a subject, they also do a subject wise ranking. And here the weightages change a little bit here and there. For example, if you look at engineering technology versus life sciences and physical sciences. For example, the citation is given more weightage in life sciences, less weightage in engineering technology. On the other hand, the industry income is given more weightage in engineering and technology. So there are some variations when you go to subject rankings in THE. So in 2019 rankings, this is how the top 10 universities look like. Oxford, Cambridge, Stanford, MIT, Caltech, Harvard, Princeton, Yale, the usual suspects. You'll all see the same institutions appearing over and over again. So these are the top universities, and even if you go down further, even the top 100 would be dominated by US and European countries. Now China, of course, and Singapore are catching up. So if you look at the Indian institutions, I know we don't do that well. So we are all 200s and below. I think everywhere, IIT Indore this year was a surprise, entry into this. I know that anybody is here from Indore. And here you see one factor which has contributed a lot probably is this citations per paper. Apparently they're not, they're publishing maybe a few papers, but they're all highly cited. So,
having all the facilities, why IAC is not coming under the first 100?
Yes, that's the question we asked ourselves. In fact,
he made a presentation, which of course he did not make it publicly, of this whole thing for all the heads of the departments, all the chairs of the departments in IAC, just in fact, 2 weeks ago. Yeah, it's basically, you know, I come to that, which is true for all institutions, you know, when I come to the later factors, but essentially where we fail most seems to be in citations for paper. You know, that is where, you know, because what we did, you know, when I was presenting the analysis, I said, you know, the rankings are truly subjective factors and so on. So we only looked at objective things like the citation for paper. You know. But even there, there is a lot to be desired. So it's we are publishing in good venues. You know, if you look at the journals, we seem to be publishing in recently good journals, but we are not having the impact in terms of citations and so on. So I think that is where we need to publish. Essentially, the problems we are tackling don't seem to be that interesting to. That seems to be the main issue, you know. So that is something the research culture has to change. Essentially, how you handle, you know, you have to take more risks. Basically, the problem is in India, you know, people tend to fall into their comfort zones, you know, and they're happy with what they do, and they feel that is enough to get their promotions and so on. So they follow a steady trajectory without really pushing the boundaries and. Going forward. So that seems to be
going for demand driven research.
Yeah.
Going for demand driven research and we go high. Right.
Yeah, it could be because you could, for example, there are many problems you know, which are unique to India, which could also, you know, lead to a lot of really interesting research. But if you always follow the trends set in the US, you know, it's going to be a problem. So.
Has any attempt been made? Map. So usually US universities do not follow these rankings. They have got the US
News and World Rankings.
Are they forthcoming in providing their data for such rankings though? Or
yeah, they do provide. So they do provide. But what I say, the US public and the US administrators, basically the only ranking they care about essentially is the US News and World Rankings.
Maybe the reason is applied
Yeah, not really. Yeah, that's, you see, one of the things you could point out. But you know, even if you look, say, even if you look at math, you know, and you compare, say, the citations per paper, we find that institutions which do more applied math obviously have more citations per paper. But then, you know, that is all because, you know, we are at a... unfortunately at a lower level, but same thing, if you look at the same citations per paper for Princeton, which has the highest citations per paper in math, that's also dominated by pure math people, but they have very high citations. So you see, it's basically the problem seems to be, you know, our scores are all at the noise level, and any perturbation either pulls you up or pulls you down and so on, and you know, can cause a lot of changes. So you will see some institutions are coming up, some going down, and things like that. But once you cross a certain level, I think then, you know, sort of all these don't matter.
So do you see any bias of the journals towards the premier institutions? For example, a paper comes from Harvard.
Yeah, that definitely, you know, is there. All these caveats would always apply, you know. So probably a paper from, as you say, paper from Harvard probably does get cited more, maybe. But you know, yeah, these are things one has to.
Is it from the university only, or there will be having quality also?
Yes, that's what. It's a circular argument. Harvard is Harvard because of its faculty, you know. So they have top-notch, world-class faculty, and they're able to choose from across the world the best people from across the world, you know, want to go there. So, yeah, you are right. I mean, so one cannot stretch these arguments too far, you know. It's okay, yeah, there may be some bias against papers published from an Indian institution, but, you know, one has to look at it more carefully.
Putting it other way around, does Harvard has some examples books of very shabby paper.
Yeah, of course, every institution, it's, you see, everywhere it's the usual 80-20% rule which applies, you know. Yeah, yeah. Well, only their 80-20 will be at a different level compared to our 80-20, but still.
So, might be their 80 must be much superior than others 20.
Yeah, so that, well, that may not be true, but still, you know, they'll also have deadwood. But you see, there they get rid of the deadwood very fast using the tenure track, you know. Process. So basically, you know, an interesting thing, I was speaking to the provost who was used to be the provost of Harvard. The way, I mean, now it has changed because it was too harsh. The way they used to do promotions is as follows. They'll send, you know, they'll not send your CV at all. They'll just send letters to 15 people asking, name the top 5 guys in this area. Okay, that's it, nothing else. So they won't send your CV, there's no, you're not being compared at all. If your name does not figure in the top 5, they'll throw you out and get the top guy from wherever that person is. So basically that is how Harvard built, you know, you need to be ruthless in these matters. But even Harvard found it very hard.
Sir, SMU to India, can you?
So even, you know, but even Harvard found it too ruthless, you know, so now they've changed it. So now they do, you know, as long as the person may not be, their own person may not be the top of that list, but as long as the person is, you know, we still be in the top band, they still, you know, give tenure. But there's only a recent change, but earlier. So, you know, you have, but tenure does play a role because it sets, you know, it makes you work, you know, at the early career level. And then you continue working. And research and teaching reputation, as you see, if you look at strategies for improvement, as far as this is concerned, so the reputation part counts for a lot in THE and QS and so on. So it is 36%. So essentially, one thing is you have to encourage faculty from other Indian institutions also, you know, whenever they get these surveys, etc., to rank each other. So because, you know, a person sitting in the US may not know much about the Indian institutions, only we know about the Indian institutions, so we should be, you know, coming forth to rank other institutions here. And you should also actively take part in international conferences, especially young faculty and students. That's how we can promote our work to the external world. Then you can also need to actively promote international research collaboration. Of course, SPARC has come up recently, but there have been many other programs, Indo-US programs and Indo-French programs and so on. So you need to actively promote international collaborations and have a large number of academic visitors. Here again, these programs would come in useful. And you also, I think, need to recruit professional staff to publicize research achievements. That is something which is lacking in Indian institutions, and highlight selected research accomplishments to visiting delegations. So that's how you sort of propagate the work that you have done in your institutions to you know, different people. So people become aware of the work done in your institution. Yeah.
Private funds for the student. So I think, you know, it's
especially IITs are in a much more comfortable position here. The alumni, they are doing well. So I think you have to, IITs have to go after their alumni and set up parallel funds for students. So that's a very critical part going forward. Because always in government circles, there's always a suspicion that foreign travel is a junket, you're just going there to enjoy and so on, so and have a good time. So that's not going to increase much. From what I hear, CPDA may go up to 5-6 lakhs. You know, that's it. So basically, therefore, we have to generate private funding. There's no other way forward. So, for as for citations, I mean, so you have to, you know, it depends on which ranking. Either you publish high impact papers, which is of course the preferred route, or a much larger number of papers, slowly sort of increase the citations, and increase faculty strength. Often in Indian institutions, the faculty strength is suboptimal in many areas. We really need many more faculty members for this. And we need to appoint star faculty. We need to go and get these faculty who are really, you know, world class, and get them and appoint them here, and implement, even if not a strict tenure system, but at least some sort of tenure system. I think that is very important, because it sends a message that quality matters. So you have to perform. And once you set the benchmark at that stage, typically, faculty have got used to performing, will continue performing. That has been the observation, you know, everywhere. So, and reward performing faculty in terms of research and travel grants. Normally, the easiest thing for administrators to do is to, you have a pot of money, you divide it equally among all researchers and students. Should not, should try to get away from that and try to, reward only performing faculty and not, everybody. Somebody who's not performing, don't give them travel grants and so on. Give it only to, you give 2 travel grants to a performing faculty, but not anything to non-performing faculty. Also promote international collaborations. This leads, multiple studies have shown that, and it's not true just for India, which may be more obvious, but even for the US, if a US faculty has a foreign collaboration, the citations tends to increase even for US papers. So therefore, international collaborations are, that is again a problem, sometimes in promotions, often people think, oh, this guy has worked with people abroad, so he has not been doing anything. I think you have to change those mindsets, so sort of give, it doesn't matter whom you're collaborating with, as long as somebody is, contributing and contributing well, that should be counted. So if you look at, if you really want to aim for the highest possible thing, if you look at the top 10 papers, which are highly cited, top 10 cited papers, you'll see all of them are methods paper. So if you want to have a simple strategy going forward of increasing your citations, concentrate on publishing very applicable methods which can be used by a large number of people. Then large number of people will use the method and cite your paper. So these are things like PCR and so on, which are so widely used these days. I don't think any. Yeah, theoretically, here density functional thermochemistry, generalized gradient approximation. This must be because of machine learning. Yes. Must have really picked up after that. So yeah, there are both experimental and theoretical methods.
Topmost one.
Topmost one, I think, is PCR.
Protein measurement.
Protein measurement. That's PCR, basically, which did the PCR first. So.
Statistics also finds a lot of.
Yes, yes. So, So that's right. But you have to publish again. Statistics journal. If you publish in a very obscure statistics journal, then you may not get many citations. So you also have to publish in an appropriate venue where others become aware.
You're right, statistics now with machine learning has become very important, but then you have to probably publish in appropriate venues.
So I suppose that's the
can publish a method. For example, if you pop the lasso method, you know, there is a statistics thing that is cited enormously, you know. So you have to, that's what I'm saying, if a surefire way of increasing, you know, citations is to publish methods papers, you know. Okay, so as far as international outlook is concerned, yeah, well, no, I think now MHRD also seems to sort of be coming around to this view that appoint foreign faculty members, not because, you know, they're necessarily better or anything, but it gives diversity to the institution, brings in different viewpoints, and I think it leads to, you know, much better interaction and increase the number of foreign students, promote international collaborations, joint supervision of PhD thesis with repeated universities is one way you can, you know, make the work better known, or joint degrees, going one step further, having joint degrees with repeated universities abroad. So these are some ways you can have, you know, can improve. Now if you look at QS rankings, again it's somewhat sort of similar. You have 40% for academic reputation, 20% for faculty to student ratio, citations per faculty is 20, employee reputation, and so on. So, this has the highest weightage in this case, and here they you know, get opinions from about 80,000 individuals. This is the world's, supposedly the world's largest survey of academic opinion. But again, you know, whether it is properly, you know, randomly sampled and so on, these are issues, you know, with all these surveys.
Did they ask for the number of faculties here as a list of academicians?
Yeah, so you can submit lists of faculty, you know, whom you want them to contact to them, but they need not go with that list. I think they have some random process of selecting it, but how random it is, etc., is we don't know. Yeah, right. So
this 40% is a really huge number.
Yes. Everything, that's right. So that's why I think, you know, if
you should do. Maybe you said you have an assignment. So basically, you know, I think you can go back and go to look at your institution. Forget about you know, all these reputation rankings, etc. We don't have access to them. They may be normalized in different ways. Just go and pick one objective measure, as I said, citations per paper is something which everybody is sort of using, but you could pick something else. So, and then, you know, do it for your, either for your department or for your institution or for whatever, you know, school or whatever you want. So, I think, you know, and find out how you, you know, stack up against the rest of the world. First, maybe compare within India and then compare across the world. So you can just look at this metric and see how you know, how you are doing. And this will be an objective metric that you can follow year over year. You know, not wait for somebody, some rank to tell you how good you are doing. So basically, yeah.
Of late, I am getting many of the requests from different institutions. To rate their institution favorably.
Yes. Actually, they should not be doing it.
Quality professor Juran was, when he was talking about this ISO and the certifications of quality, he says that certifications of quality do not contribute anything to quality. And the best products and best processes of the world do not subjugate themselves to this quality assessment at all. Like Mercedes doesn't try to use ISO 9001.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of money spent on certifications of quality.
Yes.
So I think some way around the business and procedures of ours, we need to commit ourselves more to quality.
Yes.
Than to, unfortunately, what is happening is, if you see in the rush to get this NIR ranking, some institutions are seriously doing it. Others are thinking that it is only the camouflaging and the cosmetics that can be improvised and ranks can improve.
Yeah, exactly.
The messages that are being sent by these rankings is not quite contributing to quality.
I agree. Because people want to game the rankings, you know, try to do wherever, you know, they can try to do better. I mean, in fact, even in the US, there have been cases where, you know, wrong data has been supplied to US News and World Report. That was a big scandal some years ago. So, yes, people will try to, you know, game the system. So that's why I said, you know, that's why we, in the IAC also, we now, you know, we see, okay, we have to pay heed to the rankings because, you know, they appear so prominently. But basically now we just look at our own objective measures and compare ourselves with the rest and just go about. We can calculate it any day we want, you know. So
may it not be better if some mechanism is developed where a researcher is advised that your research paper can get much higher citations with the same quantum and quality of work if you publish it to such and such journal.
There again you are falling into the impact factor trap, you know, of confusing the quality with the journal in which you are publishing. So there, I think, you know, publish. I think more important would be to publicize the work, you know. That is what now matters. Nobody has the time now to, there are so many papers appearing, nobody has the time to go through them. So I think more important to sort of publicize your own work and then ask your students to go out.
Better to publicize it to concerned people.
Yes, of course.
For numbers.
Yeah, right.
Like
so
if five concerned people of the world are reading your things and they are commenting and coming up with something new and you also get some newer idea, that should be preferable than 240,000 people citing your work and not contributing meaningfully.
See, that again depends on the area. So, say if you are in math, if five people are citing your work and commenting on it, that will be good. But if you are in biology, only five people citing and commenting on your work may not be so good, you know. So, it depends on the subject area also. So, you have to.
Sir, I'm only saying, sir, why is, WhatsApp mein Einstein ka ghoom raha hai ki machli ko ped chadne ke competition kara ke kyun assess kiya ja raha hai? I think, frankly speaking, like in this on an intellectual ecology, it is very, very difficult to judge one thing from other, and we are ultimately we are doing that only.
See, that's why you should only compare you know, subject wise.
Within the,
so you, are, you should only compare subject wise.
Unfortunately, when we are heading towards administering these promotions and processes and hiring,
yeah,
we are compelling administrators to handle the issues, and we are just trying to eliminate that subject and peer review.
Yeah. That's the problem, you know, because everybody, you know, for several reasons, as I told you, one is it is ease of this thing. You just have a number, you can use it to eliminate or select somebody. And the other is in India particularly, people are even worried about RTI court cases and so on. People think, oh, if the court says this, but I think we should not worry about it, you know, because
I think in many cases, the courts have sided with expert opinion. They have often said, you know, where expert opinion is involved, we will go with the group of experts who have said this is good or this is bad, you know.
Even with RTI, I was in video conference with Chief Inspector, Chief CIC, Chief your Information Commissioner, Jalan. Jalan said, you are perfectly all right, I am closing the case. On
right.
A single hearing, he said, the opponent is ideological, you close the case.
Yeah.
And
right.
He gave the decision.
Yeah, I think we
but
just...
there is no need to be unnecessary panic.
Panic, that is a problem, yeah. Yeah, yeah, I agree. So we should not worry too much about these things. We should do what we think is right and have a process, a transparent process, which, you know, is there. That is, I think, more important than, you know, trying to sort of have only numbers every time to justify decisions. So, yeah.
Community per se, I cite yours, you cite mine is also going on.
Yeah.
And that also has to be looked up.
Yes, yes. All these issues, any, that's what, any such metric, you know, all these issues will be there. So, you can't get away from these things. That's why, you know.
Integrity ki kami ke karan to nahi hai.
Integrity?
Ki kami ho rahi hai, individual hai. Mujhe lagta hai, sir, basically, isme values or integrity crisis. Radhakrishnan, Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan was Vice Chancellor for Banaras University, and he called the gold medalist for a cup of tea. They chatted for half an hour and he offered lectureship from the next day. A.K. Narayan, Professor A.K. Narayan of Ancient History of Banaras University. He neither saw RTI, nor saw CV,
yeah.
Nor saw anything. So, but everybody trusted Radhakrishnan.
Yes.
So somewhere down the line, why is academician losing credentials and credibility?
Yeah. See, that's true. You know, I think we should resist that.
As a class.
Yeah, I think we should resist that. I think on this score, probably the, you know, US universities and others are doing better. They take very harsh decisions and it's all based on subjective decisions, peer review and so on. But they stick by it. Yeah. Yes.
And
right.
Then he'll say, come for a cup of coffee, I've failed you.
Yeah. 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 That is the other issue in India, that we try to sort of confuse personal and professional disagreements. Okay. Any other questions?
One issue, sir. Because of this UGC, you have created this API system.
Yes. That's what, whenever you introduce such point system, then, you know, it's very bad. Because
how do you prevent somebody publishing in those kind of journals? You may delay the promotion because of the predatory journal, but by the time the damage is already happened.
Yeah.
Then University of Hyderabad publishes in predatory journal, some news item comes somewhere.
Yeah.
That spoils the reputation of, so how do we address this?
No, the only way is to get rid of, you know, the point system, you know, because it has to be by peer review. So that's the only way which, by which you can evaluate researchers. So it has, somebody has to make a subjective judgment as to the quality. But again, unfortunately, those sort of things go by impact factor. As I told you, there are so many reports. If you have to use a quantitative factor, at least use citations per paper or something. On the whole, you know, that also has problems, but on the whole, you know, if you have to use some number, at least use that.
Do you suggest Google citation is also fine? or only
it's so also fine. It tends to overestimate. I mean, because but it's also fine as long as you use it consistently. You see, so one thing is fine. Yeah.
Sir, do you think in the Indian context in science and technology, taking recourse to this ranking hoopla that has been created, there's a group of academicians who have formed a cabal to kind of just force the way in this direction? Because I do see certain sense in some of the DST committees where the funding and proportionate of most of the fundings are going in certain areas which has got very little relevance to the country. But it is because they are supposed to be the in thing to go for. Mm. And in a way, they are forcing the narrative towards that path.
Yeah.
I mean, and has there been any, there any way that you feel that course correction can be made?
No, see, those things are really, that's what I told you. We unfortunately tend to follow the trends in the West. I mean, actually, it's not that US doesn't do it. US also, they have these NSF, or DOE, or whatever you have, DARPA. They set the agenda often. But the thing is, they are very proactive. As soon as they feel something is emerging, they form, they have a workshop of all the leading researchers in that area, and they give, they chalk out what should be done in this area, and that becomes, unfortunately, the agenda for the whole world. Because you see, if you have to avoid following, you have to be very proactive. You have to know what sort of areas to be coming up, immediately act on them and fund them. We always do it very late. We sort of, now we are leading up to quantum computing, now we are leading up to, cyber physical systems. So everything, we sort of do it many years, and by then it is too late. I mean, even if you look at, the accelerators which we have, many things were done much later than when we should have been done. So the problem is again the risk-taking ability. I think you see DARPA, people hear about its success like internet, creating the ARPA and the internet started with DARPA funding and so on. But they hold a lot of money which have failed. So you have to be able to take that risk at a very early stage. That is where I think the government take up and be willing to say that I'm going to place a bet on these 10 areas, of that 9 may fail, but 1 will succeed. That we then will become a world leader. So that is where we should.
So how are we doing on time? Almost done. No?
Yeah, almost done. So may I request you to hold your questions until they finish and then we can take.
Oh, okay. No, I can, it doesn't matter. I can, I think maybe I'll go directly to the. NARF, okay.
Yes, we are interested.
Oh, NARF, sure. Yes. So, you have teaching, learning and resources takes up 30%. Research and professional practice is 30%. Graduation outcomes is 20%. Outreach and inclusivity 10%. And perception 10%. Now, if you go individually, so this 30% is split up, it's given 100 marks and split up as follows. So student strength, including doctoral students, that is 20 marks, and faculty to student ratio, where they count basically permanent faculty, that is 30 marks. And combined metric for faculty with PhD and experience, so either you have a PhD or a certain years of experience, then you are counted in this. That is 20 marks, and financial resources and their utilization 30 marks. So all this gives 100 marks, and then overall that is counted 30% in the overall weightage. And other thing, of course, NARF does is it has certain nonlinear functions by which it scales the rankings in some of the areas. It has some logarithmic functions. And unfortunately, they were supposed to publish it, but they have not published the function. I know why, but they have not published the function, so it's very difficult to reproduce the rankings, of NARF. If you want to calculate your own ranking, since you don't have access to those functions, therefore you are unable to.
Saying once if you have access, people will start bleeding. That's apparently the logic.
No, that's only the function. You see, it's basically what does it, you know, it's sort of like a logarithmic function from what you look when you try to analyze it from the data.
Where as you go up, it sort of compresses things, so you saturate at a certain point.
So that, already you can know, the general form, they might as well put the exact function. So,
the research and professional practice is 30%. So this is for publications, 35 marks. Quality of publications, 35 marks. IPR, patents, 15 and 15, so on. So then graduation outcomes is metric for university examinations, 60 marks. Metric for number of PhD students, 40 marks. So it's a very detailed sort of analysis. And graduation outcomes, if you see, it's a percentage of diversity counts, national diversity. How many people come from other states and countries, then percentage of women, the ideal. So by this, I'm assuming that you will saturate if you have 50% of students as women students, and if you get 20% of the faculty as women faculty. This seems low, but that seems to be from what is there on the website, it seems to be. And economically and socially challenged students 20%, and facilities for such students 20 marks. Then perception, this is again, they conduct a survey of people within India, and that counts for 10% perception. And this is of course the rankings which we have in this case. Basically, here one can, other than it's the same sort of analysis which goes even as compared to the other things, except for these factors like diversity. That is where I think this can be a positive push, at least in terms of diversity, of getting more women faculty, more women students, and giving access for physically challenged students and things like that. Those, I think, can be positive measures which can, lead to better, better institutions, on the whole. But otherwise, same publications, citations, it's all there, I wanted to mention this again in computer science, csrankings.org is used very often. But again, this is again falls into the same impact factor trap. That is, it only counts the top conferences in CS. And so just because you're publishing in a top conference does not mean that it's a good paper. But here, because those of you who have sat on promotion committees and hiring committees always know in CS, it's always this issue. People say journals don't count much, it's the conferences which count, so it's something to be taken care of. And this is how, this is the global ranking for CS rankings. This I'll skip. These are some points which were made by THE. I just took it from that. Maybe this right now I'll skip. But there are many nice points which were made for administrators and the top leadership. So about how you should provide incentives for your staff and monitor performance, and how you need to attract the best faculty. You have to have top leaders so that they can attract good faculty, because it says, a dean who is a successful scholar would not feel threatened by another successful person coming in, but a person who's not successful may feel threatened by a good person coming in. So the usual things, which are there, and hiring selection committees, you need to maintain the quality, and the hiring panel should again be made of top researchers, because having low quality researchers on that again will compromise the quality. and hire the best faculty. And this is something which we don't, you know, often in Indian institutions do, that if you want to get somebody, you have to just go out and get them. There's no point in saying, okay, this person will apply, I'll put an advertisement, he will apply, then I will, you know, then I will have a selection committee and hire this person. That, you know, if you really want the top class people, you just have to go and get them. I think slowly that's happening in the IITs, you know, recruitment drives are happening. So in fact, I myself had organized many years ago, you know, several directors of IITs. We had all gone once to Brown and once to Stanford for math and computer science. So that was quite successful. Many people from that, even now I meet people, faculty from IIT, etc., who tell me, oh, I attended your faculty recruitment event, and that convinced me to come back. So I think it's important that you know, we go out and attract people. So
you suggested a star faculty. One suggestion had come from
yeah.
Faculty. Will the star faculty be differentially facilitated?
That is what that is what you have to ultimately go towards. Probably it's a difficult decision because it can cause, you know, turbulence. China does it. US does it.
Hmm?
Yeah, so basically you have to have, that's where, you know, in the US it's all the deans who do it. You know, the deans decide who's to be rewarded, who's not to be rewarded, and that's it, you know. So you have to have a similar mechanism here, you know, some mechanism where you have to have, you know, give them, even if you cannot give them monetary rewards, maybe at least in terms of grants and travel grants and things like that, maybe you should empower them. So, and then, you know, also recognizing performing faculty is also very important because often, you know, they are ignored in the general scheme of things. So the top administration should, you know, always know who are doing well and keep them happy, you know. And also, I don't know whether all IITs do it, but you also have to incentivize raising research money. For example, you can make it part of the promotion decisions, and you can also permit faculty and department to keep a portion of the overheads, you know, so that they are further incentivized. That becomes, you know, money which they can use for things that they want to do. And this, generally, we have not gone to this level, but this would be the, you know, even more sort of things where if you get in a lot of research grants, you are allowed to buy out teaching time and administrative time. So, and of course, this is something which we need to do in especially Indian institutions. I think for some reason, every committee is headed by faculty, everything is done by faculty members. So I think we should get out of this whole system, hire professionals who will, you know, do the work for us. So faculty should only be involved in proper academic committees, you know, evaluation, hiring, and things like that. We just spend too much time on, you know, administrative committees also. So I think that should be really cut down. It's more at the leader level. I mean, so. But here there's one point, you know, if you're the kind of director who mainly wants to be liked or likes to compete with your faculty members, don't take the job. So it's and this, yeah, this is, I guess, the purpose of this meeting. It also says, you know, start training the scholars in management when they are young. So let me summarize. So basically, the overall rank of Indian universities, most rankings is below, you know, 250. So the key factors seems to be lack of sufficient citations to our papers and lack of publications in top journals. So so this, as I said, you know, need not can be a problem also, probably. That need not lead to higher citations. So, but the essential issue is that we need to choose problems carefully in order to increase the impact. And in engineering disciplines, especially, you have to increase interactions with the industry because many interesting problems come from the industry. So you need to interact more with them.
and actively take part in international conferences, actively promote international research collaborations. As I said, that leads to higher citations. Then this is something which is, of course, strong, badly lacking in Indian universities, a strong postdoc culture. Because with a good postdocs, you get immediate productivity because they're fully trained, they come and start doing the work. Or if you want to get into a new area, they allow you to get into a new area immediately. This is one area where Western institutions do far better than us. They have a very strong postdoc culture. And we also need to substantially increase endowment and alumni funding so that we can support travel and all these. Maybe if you want to give additional incentives to faculty and students, all these have to come from such endowment and alumni funding. We cannot get it from MHRD and so on. I need to appoint, as I said, star faculty. Maybe you provide joint appointments to international faculty like China and Singapore have successfully done. You know, me, faculty in the US who are of Chinese origin go back to China and spend 5-6 months a year there and set up labs, and that leads to much higher visibility and so on. But then providing them higher salaries like China has done could be a double-edged sword because it can destroy the equilibrium within the campus. But still, even if you don't do it monetarily, you have to somehow find a way of rewarding productive faculty. You cannot keep on distributing everything equally to everybody. So you have to have some way of rewarding productive faculty and not do it. And then have a tenure system and also provide substantial faculty startup grants, because when they come in, they need support to be able to set up the facilities and start ramping up their activities. So at the initial stage, you have to provide a lot of support. After that, they are on their own, so they have to do it. And then as far as reputation rankings, since that has a huge component in PhD and QS, you have to increase cooperation between Indian institutions. You have to have sustained PR outreach, have large number of national and international visitors, and we have both organize and also participate in international conferences. But I would say this part, I am not too worried about this part, because the reputation part is something which we can worry about later. But now I think we have to more worry about these objective measures like citations and so on, where we need to have greater impact. Then you could have a high level standing committee that continuously monitors rankings and formulates studies. Again, as I said, it need not be rankings. It could be objective measures that you yourself calculate for your institution and keep on monitoring it and seeing how it goes. And then we have to talk to administrators from other universities, find out what strategies work for them. Because universities like NUS, NTU, TU Delft, Melbourne, they've all come up rapidly, in the past 1 or 2 decades. And of course, the Chinese universities. So we have to find out, good strategies from them also. Okay, that's it. Thanks.
What are your thoughts on the US system, where for 9 months you get paid, and the remaining 3 months, if you can earn your way through your research grant? Because rather than going in for absolutely a tenured system, which is going to be sending quite a bit of ripples, why not try with that approach?
You could do that. I've been mentioning this in many places. But then the funding agencies also need to change. Right now, as a grant, you cannot get personal money. So it has to be done at both levels, at funding agency level and at the institutional level. Then you allow permit people to draw personal grants from the funds. But yes, there is one thing which incentivizes people to work harder for grants.
Yes.
What is your rationale?
No, that's what I was talking to you. I was pointing out there that the citations per.
I'm just taking the publications also. That does not reflect this. I mean, this is my personal opinion.
Yeah. So you see, that's the thing. I mean, what could be happening is, if they may have few papers, they may not be publishing much, but the few papers they're publishing, some of them may be having a lot of citations. Okay, so in that case, your citations per paper would, you know, give them a high score. So in such cases, you know, it's better to avoid publishing just an average or bad paper. It's better to concentrate on publishing, even if there are few, your few good papers. So one has to go into the details of each subject and see, you know, what subjects they're publishing, because it's an overall ranking. You know, in your subject, the maybe the papers are not so good, maybe, but there is some other subject where they are really, you know, doing very well. So one has to see that. Yeah.
Overall, sir, my personal feedback that I got for IIT Indore is they have evolved good the ecosystem for research.
Research.
Mm. And being a new institute, they are doing well.
Yeah.
That's a personal feedback that I had from the
people. The last question.
Paid and no, nobody cares about whether it's paid or not paid. As long as it is in one of the index, either Scopus or you know, SCI or one of those, that's all. It doesn't distinguish between.
Okay, I think we can now.
Sir, I have
one
believe that the differences in performance of the university and institutes in India, it is because of the governance systems.
Mm.
Particularly, if you see the rating of IISc, compare with IIT and other universities, always IISc and similar institutes are ranking top. What is your opinion that if all this system removed and it is make like IISc, whole governance system?
Yeah, you see, even IISc, yeah, it's okay. In Indian context, IISc, you know, maybe doing better. But in the international context, still IISc still has a long way to go. So it's not, I don't know whether one can say, but at least IISc, you know, some things which it does probably better are, you know, having a tenure system, having, you know, peer review for, you know, evaluation of faculty, like that, but you know, but still, even IISc has a long way to go. So I don't know whether put parts of it, I think, are worth emulating, because it has proved the test of time over 100 years.
IISc is behind probably because of intellectual imperialism throughout the world.
Hmm.
This is because of the US and UK, all those. Who are maintaining educational heritage.
Mm.
We are not maintaining. We have forgotten our old education system.
Yeah.
They are maintaining Cambridge skills.
Mm.
They are maintaining Oxford skill. But we are not maintaining our old system.
Yeah. That's a very sad part, that we have destroyed our universities. No, university should have been number one, number two in all these rankings. Everywhere is universities. Know, fulfilling, because that is where you get the diversity of thought. You know, you have the arts, you have the sciences, you have the law. You have, so that diversity also adds to that intellectual vigor of the campus. You know, we somehow want to keep on setting up more and more specialized institutions, catering only to a small subset of areas. But that's because, of course, we thought, okay, universities were too politicized, so let's get out of it. But I think, had you know, set the made universities right, I think that would have been a better solution than setting up all the institutions.
Okay, so with that, I think we should stop. But before we thank let me ask him a question. More, can articulate again so that they can write it down, because it's in the middle.
Okay, so basically, what I would say is just do, you know, this analysis with any one metric. Google Scholar or just pick only one metric, citations per paper, and you know, this one reasonably good metric,
and do it for your either your department or school or institution, and then also do it for a few others, comparable institutions within India and a few abroad. Well, from Google Scholar you can get it, but or I don't know, IIT Kanpur has access to the databases.
No, you asked a question.
Yeah. Huh?
It's a question. On the basis of
presentation. Okay.
I think Google Scholar will give you type, of course, it's very strict. Is there?
Yes, it's strict. No, but I don't know if you can. If IIT Kanpur has access to some of these databases, then it can be provided.
Scopus is there.
Yeah,
right?
The institute has it, but it's good. They don't have it.
They don't have it.
We can do this.
Once we are back, we can.
So you can send it after you.
Okay, so the next time, Professor.
No, no. What's the question finally, please?
Okay.
Oh, no. Basically, take any objective metric, like citations per paper or whatever you would like, and then just compare your own in the department or institution with other institutions in India and. Some comparable institutions abroad. So basically, that's what will give you an idea of how you stand. So otherwise, it'll just be an abstract exercise. You really need data to back all this up.
Okay, so let's make a motion.